Welcome to the Hiring and Empowering Solutions podcast. My name is Molly McGrath, and this podcast is dedicated to providing the key ingredients to transform your employees into a dream team that create consistent results in every aspect of the business, including leadership, team empowerment, business development, communication, hiring, and yes, sadly, firing should the time come for that. As some of the country's leading staffing and management consultants, we help business owners, i.e. entrepreneurs, and the team that support them, i.e. intrapreneurs, to powerfully connect and work together to grow the business together and create a dream team. Today's episode, we are so very excited about. This is about when you hold on to an underperforming employee for far, far, far too long, and how to finally fire quickly with confidence, ease, and certainty. I'm so excited about our guest today, Kelly Keller, nationally known as a trademark girl, rocks.com. Kelly is an attorney that focuses in the trademark industry from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. She's also an entrepreneur and a relentless legal and business educator. Kelly teaches strategies to help build and protect the business you want, not the business you have. And whether we can find her presenting to small business owners, meeting and counseling with clients in her conference room, whether she's working on the creative or coaching professionals, digital entrepreneurs, attorneys, college students, or corporate executive, Kelly successfully connects the legal and business implications of turning intellectual property, innovation, and ideas into valuable business assets in a way that her audience and clients understand. So welcome, Kelly. I'm so very excited to have you here today.
Thank you, Molly. I'm very excited to have this conversation, something we've talked about many times.
Yes, yes. And Kelly and I had met, over a year or so ago last summer, I think it was. And I remember I was reflecting on this, and I know we were talking about this a little bit before we hit the record button this morning, but some of the questions, you know, that when you and I started talking, one of the areas was you're feeling very frustrated with an employee that you had that was underperforming and really made you feel like you were, these are some of the words I remember you saying, you felt like you're being held hostage in your own practice. And I would love if we could just kick it off and really, I know you have an amazing amount of tips, techniques, and insight for us today, but can you share with us a little bit about, in hindsight, now sitting where you are right now, talk to us a little bit about what was keeping you from simply making that decision and firing someone when you started seeing all the signs that they weren't a fully vested employee, that they didn't have your back, that they weren't fully involved in integrated within your practice, your personal vision, your personal goals, and kind of, you know, reflecting back some of the things that kept you maybe tolerating, is a word that I hear quite often from attorneys, a less than stellar employee for far too long.
Certainly. And, you know, this was such an important learning experience for me because at the time that I had this employee, she was part-time and I was in a big state of sort of evolution and change with my law practice, making some decisions. Do I turn right? Do I turn left? It was really at a fork in the road. And it almost felt like I was going back into startup mode. And as anybody who started a business knows, it can be very messy. It's a lot of starting and stopping and re-examining and thinking. I usually just say to people who are, whether they're clients I'm counseling or team members, I'm like, look, this is how the sausage is made. It's not pretty. It's just what you have to do. And so with this particular employee, when I just was like, it's just not connecting. We got along very well, but I didn't understand why when I would give her instructions, they weren't translating and she wasn't able to implement or execute and in a way that I expected her to. I kept thinking, maybe it's because I'm not clear enough with her. Maybe it's because she doesn't have, her job description isn't you know, defined enough. It kept being sort of the self-reflection. What am I doing wrong so that she's not able to perform? And I think it's an important analysis to do that, to see if there's a way that you can course correct. But once I sought help, and Molly specifically, I reached out to you to say, what is holding me back? You know, what is this really about? I realized that I don't always have to be the one to fix, that I need to make sure I have somebody who's a good fit for where we're at that time in the business. So we started doing some personality profiles to see if that was really a good fit or not. So what I would say, in a situation where you feel like maybe you're doing something wrong, take a hot minute and examine that. And if there's something that you need to fix, and it's a pretty quick fix, then, you know, then go ahead and implement that. But if it's not taking, and you keep seeing time and time again that the way you're communicating to them and the way they're receiving the information, and the lack of implementation or incorrect implementation, to get some advice, is there just a misfit here from a personality perspective that we need to move on, either shift them into a different position or just say, it's time to go? That was a huge issue for me. It was a lot of, I would really say, self-blame. The other thing with that particular situation, it was a highly sensitive cultural situation, and there were a lot of moving parts, and it's a very highly charged political time that we live in, and you don't want to do or say anything that could seem offensive or frustrating to somebody. And I was just really, really on eggshells. When you're making sausage and you're behind the scenes, you are not, you know, we're not always at our highest and best from an etiquette perspective. And I really struggled because I had a lot of respect for this person. Their personal journey had been a very difficult one. And so I was really struggling with balancing some of this sort of cultural issues that were at play. And that was really making me feel like I was being held hostage, because here I have a communication issue, but I also am walking on eggshells all of the time. So again, by reaching out to a professional and saying, here are my issues, I don't know how to deal with them, I was able to move past them. But I think anybody who is dealing with a situation where they have an employee who's simply underperforming, or the personality has become bigger than the job and the performance of the job, you need to get a little bit of advice and guidance. And I will say how we brought resolution to this situation, which I thought was brilliant, because there felt like there was so much emotion. It was a very emotionally charged situation, was to say, hey, listen, employee, I'm working with a coach and we're talking about how to build a really strong team. As you said in the introduction, a team that really, you know, becomes your dream team. And I need to take a pause. I need to pause for 30 days, regroup, shift, make sure we're doing the right thing. So we just need to take a break, and I'll be back in touch with you in 30 days and we'll talk about next steps. It was the perfect way to kind of, you know, take all of the sting out of the bite, give me a chance to step back and realize, is it me? Is it her? Or is it just not, maybe it's neither of us. It's just not a match made in heaven.
Wow. You said so many amazing little value bombs there that I really want to highlight. I love that you know, attorneys are very literal and a lot of times like a strategic plan, if you will. And what I love that you said was step one was you took that pause and you took stock of your personal responsibility and the part that you possibly were playing in the misalignment of this relationship, this employee being able to meet you where you're at to accomplish the goals that you had set out. And I love that you said step one is really just pausing and seeing where you maybe play part. And a lot of times I find that attorneys spend employers spend way too much time in this area. But you really made it really simple for us, Kelly, because what I'm hearing is, okay, step one, am I giving them clear direction? What I'm expecting from them. Step two, do they have a very clear job description that matches and it's in alignment with what I need from them? So the direction and the job description and who's doing what to reach goal, is that clear? And I love that you spent time there. And then step three, you took yourself out of it because you knew that it was highly emotionally charged. And you knew that you were feeling like you were walking on eggshells and possibly triggered by what she was or wasn't doing. And then you seeked out professional help. And you got a coach to say, okay, help me unpack this and get some clarity in which direction I need to move. And what I love about that is we made it really simple. We started with the assessments, and I remember that. And the assessments came back, and they were very, very clear. This person's not a strong follow through. This is why you're having a breakdown here, because a lot of the assessments that we use were, number one, solutions, how they innately make decisions when it comes time for fight or flight. Number two, it measures their communication style. And then number three, also their personality, their DNA. And so when we were able to do that, and I remember that conversation that we had, I said, you know, you had a laundry list of all the things that weren't working and what she wasn't doing and why she wasn't a good fit, et cetera. And as you said, it was highly emotionally charged. You knew that she had her personal journey was a hard one. And I love that you brought that in, because a lot of times as employers, when people come in and start interviewing with us, and we see that they have some grit, they have some tenacity, they have a personal journey that they've overcome, that they're, you know, aware of, that they're spending time trying to really better themselves. We always fight for the underdog, and I hear this all the time from people. And then sometimes that's a blessing and a curse, because when it does come time for course correction, for those crucial conversations, and if it does ultimately come down to firing, then the thing that attracted us the most to them is the thing that hinders us the most for making these business decisions. So I love that you brought all of those pieces into play. And I remember the conversation that we said is that don't go into all the things of why you're letting her go. Let's, you know, I always tell people, blame it on me. Just say, I hired a coach and right now we're taking the business in a different direction, and make it a business conversation. It's, you know, I think you and I were talking about this earlier. My favorite quote from We Bought a Zoo is, all it takes is 20 seconds of insane courage. And when you can find that, and you can make it very simplistic, and you can anchor to facts, not emotions, which you were able to do beautifully, and you have the ability to just say, it's not you, it's me. Because, and I remember us having this conversation so often, when employers let employees go or have to have crucial conversations, they spend so much time over justifying it, going into all the reasons and going into the depths of why it's not working, versus just anchoring to the facts and just making it a 5-minute conversation, just making it a business conversation, make it about the business. And then, because you're not going to want to, people typically come from that place of one, justification, but then number two, thinking that they're quote unquote helping them by giving them this all on this unsolicited coaching advice. Maybe they could carry on and it'll help them with their journey and their next position. And I always say, if they were open to coaching and they were really seeking that out, you wouldn't be having a conversation about firing in the first place, right?
Absolutely. And that's a very hard reality, especially for those of us who are deep empaths and we feel deeply and we care. I always say, you know, nerves mean you care. And being, you know, nervous or scared or concerned about hurting somebody's feelings, those types of things, it's particularly challenging. But when you're stepping into your role as the CEO of your business, as opposed to a woman or a man who is empathetic for somebody in their personal situation, you're seeing it with different eyes through a different lens, and you're having a different conversation. So you're having an employer-employee conversation, not a sort of a colleague, not a colleague or a friend or an acquaintance conversation. The dynamic's different. You've got to kind of step into that different zone.
I always tell people that play games with yourself to keep yourself very rooted and grounded into this is a business decision. And you said two things about nerves mean you care. I love that because it is. It's taking acknowledgement. This is a human being. I hear this all the time from entrepreneurs that I feel responsible for their livelihood. And one of the greatest things that my very, very first coach in 1997 taught me was that you can't care more about somebody's future than they do. And I always, always anchor to that when it comes time for making a decision, because it's true. You can't carry the weight of all that. It needs to be very much where it's give and take and give and take. They show you evidence of I'm open to coaching. I'm open to that 2 millimeter shift I talk about all the time, that if you give me a piece of information that I am going to course correct, that I am going to be deeply curious and invested in enhancing and improving my part of it. So that I love that it means that you care, yes, but you always want to remember I need to put the oxygen mask on me first, and I need to make certain that I'm caring about my business. I'm caring about my energy and I'm caring about my future first and foremost. And if this person doesn't line up with that, then I need to give them a gift of giving them an opportunity to self-select out and go find what does work for them.
That is such a good takeaway, putting the oxygen mask on first. And I often say to myself, you know, Kelly, you can't fly the plane while you're building it. Stabilize, build the plane, and then fly it, then land it, fix it, and then fly it again. We're constantly flying and building. We're not taking care of our businesses. We're not honoring it in the way that we should. And we're not being in full integrity with the business because we're constantly worrying about hurting other people's feelings. And those are very normal human emotions, especially for women. But I really like that. Such a good reminder to put the oxygen mask on first and have that. I mean, that's amazing. 20 seconds of insane courage. And when you have it, you're like, man, why was that so hard? It just wasn't, because you just spent 20 days stressing yourself out about it. And those 20 seconds are just really incredible. And you may hurt someone's feelings, but like you said, I mean, that's so good. I used to do this all the time. If I care more about their future than they do, I'm going to care more about hurting their feelings than their feelings were actually hurt. So it's just really, as you would say, out of alignment, because we're approaching it from the wrong perspective. And it's really, really good. I mean, that's just such a good takeaway, is to put your oxygen mask on first. Always. You cannot help anybody else, and you cannot keep this thing going if you don't have a full tank and you can't breathe.
Yeah. You know, and you know what I love about this too, that just hit me as you were talking, because when you sat down and had that 20-second conversation, give or take, that was in essence, I'm going to put the brakes on the business. I'm going to pause. We're going to work on branding, our direction, et cetera. And I'll reach back out to you in 30 days. And as her assessments had shared with us, she's not a strong follow through or project manager or leader. And it's really fascinating, because then I believe you never heard back from her. You didn't follow up with her, but she also didn't come back to you and say, okay, great. Are we ready to hit the ground running now?
Not at all. Not at all. And that was equally as instructive. Absolutely. Mm. To go back, if I can make a point on what you were saying, that your first coach talked about, where it's a give and take, and you know, there's two people in this relationship. I remember, this is just sort of a funny anecdote. Long time ago, when I was trying to decide if I should break up with a boyfriend or stay in the relationship, or trying to figure out why it wasn't, quote, working. And I was working with a counselor on some other stuff in my life, and this came up. And I'll never forget, she's like, you give a little, and then you pause and you wait for them to give a little. You give a little, they give a little. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. And if you're not getting back, you're not getting the feedback, you're not getting a response of any kind, or you're getting the wrong response, it's simply like, it kind of like defies the laws of nature, so to speak. It's just not a fit. And it's okay to call a duck, recognize it is what it is, and move on. And that really has stood with me a long time, where it's like, you know, it does take two to tango. And even though, I mean, we are in human relationships, these are not robots that we're giving commands to. And if we think about it that way, it is appropriate for us to have an expectation for employees to be responsive, to engage, and to participate fully in the role they have agreed to play. And that we should always expect that, not only of them, but of ourselves. And as soon as it's out of alignment, you try to course correct. If it doesn't work, you have that 20 seconds of courage, you move on, and you find a new dance partner.
Wow. That was amazing. I love that analogy of, you know, that these are humans that we're dealing with, not robots. And even that dance, if you will, that takes two to tango, it's so incredible because that's your evidence right there. Like, let's just make it very, very simplistic with that analogy. And you sit down with your employee and you share, okay, this is where I'm at. This is what I need. I always tell people in your weekly meetings, talk about what's working or what's not working, what is working, where I'm jammed up, where I feel like I'm a bottleneck, where I feel like I'm drowning, and where I need help. And when you communicate that and you use a simple formula, even like you use with that analogy with dating, is, and then you see the person come back and give and give and more and try to relieve your stress or try to fill your gas tank, if you will, and try to make your life easier. And vice versa, when your employee shares that, I'm in the weeds with blah, 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 and I can't get this done. And you say, great, how about this as a solution? And you do that dance back and forth. That's when you know, okay, this is a person that I am invested in really caring and giving them and investing in them. But then when you don't see that, I get the phone calls all day, every day, where people are like, you know, I tell her this, I had to sit down here, I had to come Jesus meeting here, and nothing's changing. And that's where you kind of bring back that, well, you can't care more about their future than they do. It doesn't matter. And a lot of times, like you said, I think that we keep going back and back to ourselves. Well, maybe I didn't say it really clear. The common one I hear, well, they really don't have a job description. A superstar, and I'd love for us to move into this on the flip side of when you did find a superstar, once you had the courage to just say, okay, we're done, this isn't working. And then you took the pause. And then when you did find your superstar, honestly, that's such an indication when you have your employees coming to you and saying, well, I don't have a clear job description. I hear that all the time. I'm still waiting on my job description. I'm like, create your job description for the love of God. Like, a superstar doesn't need a job description. And sometimes, yes, as employers, we're not very clear. Many of us are highly entrepreneurial, maybe very high quick starts, where you don't have a lot of time, energy, direction, clarity. Heck, you want somebody to tell you what to do, is what I hear from attorneys all the time. And you know it when you experience it and you see it, and your teammate members do see that you're spinning out of control. You don't have the time to give to them. There's not a lot of clarity and direction. You might not have a job description. Many people listening to this podcast are small solo business owners. So when you have one or two employees and a couple independent contractors, and you don't, when you hire that superstar and you maybe don't have all the direction, because like you said, Kelly, you're trying to build the sausage and deliver to clients and get the phone to ring and to get money in the door. When you have superstars, and I'd love for you to talk to us about this, they direct you. They say, okay, time out, sit down. Right now, I'm going to pull out the whiteboard. I want you to puke everything that's on your head, everything that's in your heart, and I want you to just dump it. I'm going to hold the puke bucket here for you, and I'm going to capture everything for you. And somebody that is willing to step up and lead, and a superstar, when you have a superstar, that's the essence that they bring to the table. They don't put it all on you to come up with job descriptions and direction and all that. They see that it's their job to meet you and to help you get that power of the pause, be able to download it. And then together, you can very simplistically create that.
Absolutely. You know, and as you know, I currently have an amazing superstar, which it's like, where have you been all of my life? Another funny analogy. I remember when I bought my very first piece of property, I bought a condo, and I was 26 years old, and the day we closed and I came in and it was new construction. So, you know, you had like contractor white paint, you know, gray carpet. And it was super simple. And I just laid down and I've been like, I've been looking for love in all the wrong places. It was like, it finally is here, this sense of fabulousness. And you can just even hear in the tone of my voice, you're like, yes, you're not trying to dance carrying, you know, a bunch of baggage, and you're not carrying a limp body that's not actually working with you. And it gives you a sense of security, not that everything is going to be perfect, but that they are not going to leave because making sausage is too messy for them, that they aren't going to be judgmental because it isn't, picture perfect all of the time. I mean, when you go to a concert or you go to a play, there's a lot of time and energy and a lot of moving parts to make it look that, you know, that production to look like that for, you know, it to be ready for a particular audience. But somebody who can get their hands dirty and be okay with that, it's just such a great feeling. It's almost like you feel like your feet are firmly planted and you're rooted and the wind isn't going to sway. You know, you're not built on a house of cards. I know that's a lot of different analogies, but those are what keep coming to mind. And in my particular situation, the other thing that's so great is when we can say, we're able to get out of the way, hey, listen, just, I got to cut to the chase. You can't get your feelings hurt. We've just got to deal with this. We're in business mode all day. It's not about you. And I don't want to have to keep saying it's not about you, but that doesn't work. We need to pivot. It's time to make a change. This process isn't working. It's not performing. I need you to do this. And to constantly, and to have somebody who's like, I'm on it, and they're able to pivot with you and will actively engage in constructive suggestions. And as you're saying, to hold the puke bag, it's like you'll know it when you see it. And it's such a change that you realize you never have to hire mediocrity again, and you never have to settle for that, at least, you know, in those positions that require somebody to be more than mediocre. It's incredible. And it's a gift you give yourself. And a lot of us don't feel like we are capable of having that, or that we're advanced enough to require that or demand that, that somehow we haven't evolved to a point where we can demand that level of excellence and performance. But the truth is, you can't afford not to demand that from the get-go, because you just lose. I mean, I can't tell you how many years and how many dollar bills I've lost over not firing fast enough and then hiring the right thing fast enough. Mm. So a whole different feeling, like we're in it to win it. I've got a team member who's going to support me, and they're not trying to be me. They're not trying to take over my job. They're not trying to be the person in the spotlight. And for entrepreneurs, that's always a challenge. She's the right personality fit for what I need. And I think we come down to that personality piece. Personality, just how we're wired, is hugely important. And I think that's such an important part of the hiring process now. You can say anything in an interview. You can be amazing in an interview, but it's not until we take you off script and we see how you really are that we see how you're going to perform. And when you see, you know, maybe if their DNA just isn't going to allow them to be a leader in the way you need them to be, I mean, they just don't have the raw materials. It's just not going to work. And so that's just something that has really stuck with me, is getting the right personality. And in many ways, you know, Molly, it's not even about skills. It's about gray matter and raw materials and a willingness to learn and engage. Because as we're growing and evolving businesses in this digital age, you know, we're always on the frontier of something new. There's always a new way of communicating, of delivering information. Nobody knows everything because it hasn't happened yet. So having somebody who's like, we're on it, we're in it, and they're a step ahead of you. If every single small business owner had that person, my particular person calls herself the squire to my knight. You know, like she's my shield maiden. She's the, you go to the doctor and they're like, who's your, in case of emergency person? She's my person. who's that person who's got your back? It is an absolute must. It took multiple times, multiple people and multiple interviews to get it right. But do not settle until you know. And you know, it's like they say, it's like picking a life partner. You know, when you know, when you know. It's the same thing about getting the right superstar employee. You just know it in your bones.
That is so true. Wow. And you know, when you come from a place of breakdown, which you did with an employee that just was not the right fit for you, beyond every breakdown is a breakthrough. And I think, so if you're listening to this and you are in a place of friction or resistance or turmoil with an employee, I love what Kelly's saying. She is a walking testament to that, that I even posted this quote on Facebook this morning. You are not falling apart. You are coming together. And when things are feeling like they're falling apart, that is such a crucial, crucial gift. That contrast is for you to say, oh, I am on the brink of a breakthrough. I need to pause. I need to pay attention to this. I need to take stock of what's causing this friction for me. I need to make a decision. And then what I love that you said, Kelly, is after that incident of letting someone go, you were very, very clear on what you wanted. Most times when, and most of you know, I spend all day hiring, and that's a big portion of our practice. And what I love about it is when attorneys come to us and say, okay, they didn't work out, I need someone, I make them get very, very clear. Tell me how you hired the person you just let go of. And 9 out of 10 times, to your point, it's about the skills. It's about their resume. They get seduced by the resume. They don't spend enough time on the human side of things in the interview. They're like, okay, great. You know Word, you know Excel, you know how to draft, you know how to do this, you're hired. Because we, and no blame, but we typically hire from a place of pain because we waited too long to bring that person in. So then that we learn our lessons. This time, you use such a crucial, crucial word that I really want to put in the spotlight right now: demand. And I think as attorneys, so often we're so conscious of not being demanding because of the stigma and all the social pieces that come with it, where they feel like attorneys are demanding and blah, blah, blah. I really would love to invite everyone to shift your mindset around this. You absolutely should demand and be unapologetic of what you need from the very first communication that you have with the potential new hire. And we even say this when we do our phone interviews with people. We hire from mindset, emotional intelligence. And the first thing I always say to them is, listen, you're walking into a practice where they tolerate nothing but adult conversations. If you take things personally, if you get your feelings hurt, the attorney's under a tremendous amount of pressure and stress. They have clients coming at them, their family coming at them, they have cash flow to worry about, they have everything. If you can't hang, and not only hang and survive in this conversation, but actually push and direct it, this is not a place for you. And this is like in minute 4 of the first phone interview. And it's amazing because it's either a hell yes or hell no, of which camp people go into. Oh, I'm not going to tolerate that. My last boss was so, so bossy. Okay, thank you for your time. Hang up. The other person's like, I take that as a complete honor that they're willing to trust and be vulnerable and share the ins and outs of their business, because I can't help them if I don't know the state of the union, if I don't know the truth of what's going on behind closed doors, what's going on in their head. The more that they can share with me, then the better employee that I could be to direct and help and systematize their practice.
That's fantastic. It's, and you know, as you're speaking, now you're speaking to your audience, and I'm while I'm your guest, I'm your audience for purposes of this conversation, because we constantly need to be reminded of that. And I love that you are not falling apart. You are coming together, just that, just flipping that script, and somebody who wants to be a part of the coming together. And as you say, can be, you know, an adult in the room, ain't got no time for that hurt feeling stuff. You know, a friend of mine, we always say that something happens, I look at her, she looks at me, I ain't got no time for that. I got stuff to do, people to meet, places to go, and deadlines to meet, right? It's like, let's move on. I think it's just so good, and just cut through the garbage, get to the bottom line, and demand it for yourself. We have high standards in a lot of other areas of our lives, and we need to do the same for ourselves as business owners. And it can take, sadly for so many of us, we just have to have breakdown after breakdown in order to understand and inhabit the breakthrough. But when you do, it's so rewarding. And if you can learn from other people's mistakes and not have to have as many breakdowns, you're just all the better for it.
And I love that even with your superstar now, when you initially made the decision to hire her, that was one of the, I remember a key conversation that you had. You can't take things personal. I move at lightning speed. You always say that. I move at lightning speed, and I need you to do one of two things. Keep up with me when you need to, and slow me down when I need to. And just rein me back in and keep me on task. And that, for there's such a small percentage of people that take that calling, not challenge, calling on to say, absolutely sign me up, when they're in the space of a leader leading leaders, and understand that. So for anyone listening, listen to some of the key words that Kelly and I are sharing with you that you want to plug in your interviewing process as you go along. And if you don't feel like you can hang up today and listening to this and walk in and use these words with your key employees, and you know you don't have the right people on the bus, it's really that simplistic to take them out for a cup of coffee, take them out for lunch, and say, listen, I feel like I'm spinning. I need someone who has my back. I need a soft place to land where I can have an honest, well, respectful conversation, share everything that is weighing me down right now, and for you to be able to handle it and help me to manage it and direct it. And if they look like a deer in the headlights, or they have a panic attack, or go to a place of overwhelm, or say, I don't have a job description, what do you mean? Then you know they're not the right person. Because when you have somebody who is very much there, they understand their greatest job is to protect your time, to protect your energy, to protect you, how you show up in the marketplace, to protect your back, that they do think about your calendar, they do think about your cash flow, and you have the ability to even have adult conversation without them taking it personally, then when you experience that and you get to say, listen, I do have high standards. And I tell my employees this all the time. I have unrelenting standards. And these are my expectations. And if we can meet these expectations, and I'm very, very forgiving and generous and flexible in other places, but these are the key areas that I am unrelenting about. And I need to not feel bad about that, or people using it as a weapon. You know, so often people say, nothing's ever good enough. I'm like, baloney, you don't ever get to say that again. As an entrepreneur, nothing is ever good enough. And you don't take that as a negative. That's as a positive, because how can we ever be in a place of up-leveling? How can we always be on the path of growth and constant improvement if we are not paying attention and looking at and doing a Kaizen and an analysis and saying, where can we improve? Where can we create a better experience for our clients and for our referral sources and internally for us as an employee, so we can anchor to a place of ease and consistency and flow? Because at the end of the day, that's what everybody wants. They want to feel like we're on the conveyor belt where things are moving, instead of being in a blender all day. And that's ultimately why nothing's ever good enough, because I want to make certain we never go back to feeling like we're in the blender and we're on the conveyor belt.
That is just, that's just gold right there. Every bit of that is gold. I love that unrelenting. you have to be unrelenting and unapologetic. And I heard something the other day that I think is apt for this conversation as well. And there's this conversation about criticism and affirmation and how we as human beings, we need an awful lot of affirmation. That's one of the ways that we grow in confidence. And if I translate this into sort of the employer-employee relationship, it is appropriate for us to affirm our people for who they are, but we don't have to affirm what they do if it's not right. It's okay to be affirming for who you are, your commitment, who you are as a person, but to be critical of the things they're doing if they don't actually work for the business, and to not mix that up where we think, I'm going to hurt their feelings and so on and so forth. What you're doing is you're simply not affirming behavior that is not constructive or mission oriented. And that was a really good thing for me, because I'm not disaffirming them as a person. I'm simply addressing the sort of the business execution or the business performance or lack of performance. I don't know if that makes sense, but that was something.
Oh, yes, it does. Yes, it does. Because even when you have a superstar, you don't even have to really necessarily worry about that, right? So you do, when you do give that affirmation you don't have the affirmation there consistently, you know, by their response of how they are, again, it just keeps coming back to where they are a healthy whole person, because they're already giving themselves that. They don't need the constant attaboys, if you will. And when you are giving it to them, it's not wrecking or amplifying their day, because there's not this void that you're responsible for as a entrepreneur, as an employer. But when you do give it, it's like rocket fuel, but it's rocket fuel that's already coming on traction and energy that's already been there. It's not that you're fulfilling a deficit.
That's very good, because I've always, for me, and I'm sure others listening to this feel exactly the same way. If I could be more affirming, give every criticism and a compliment sandwich, you know, one criticism in the middle, but something good on either side of it. And at the end of the day, I'm like, I'm so exhausted. Could we just bottom line? Because I think you've said it's, you know, when you are able to say good job, excellent, it does feel like rocket fuel for both of you. But as you say, you're doing it because there's already traction and energy. If you have to create the traction and the energy and the rocket fuel, you're not getting help. You're just being exhausted. You're not getting the help and the support you need. And just don't settle until you get what you need, and be unapologetic, be demanding, and set the highest possible standards that you can set for yourself. We do that when we buy our own, you know, we buy our food, we choose the products we buy, we decide where we get our hair done, the clothes we have, the shoes we have a set of standards for ourselves, and we don't, you know, I just won't buy it if I can't get what I want. It's the same thing for running the business. Don't buy it until you get what you want. And just wait. You don't have to settle. And I loved what you said earlier, that we're doing a lot of this from a place of, I don't know if it's a place of fear or a place of brokenness or a place of anxiety, because we're hiring because we waited too long and now we need somebody quickly, and we're kind of constantly behind the eight ball instead of getting out in front of the problem. And so we feel like we have to settle because chicken licking, the sky is falling and everything's going to be a nightmare if I don't fix this. But all you've done is bought a very expensive Band-Aid.
Oh, I love that. You know, wow, you just said something, so many things, but what really stuck out, why do we tolerate, you know, excellence, or why do we expect excellence and we don't tolerate anything but when it comes to products and services and things in our personal life. But when it comes to our business, I love what I saw was a line of delineation between products and people. And I think when it comes to the people side of things, the human side of things, we bring all this, this unnecessary emotion to it of about feelings and about, you know, overthinking and putting all the responsibility on us versus maybe, and you know me, I'm always the advocate about empowered employees. I am about creating culture and all that, but sometimes often you need to really make it simple and transcend what you expect out of your shoes, your food, your house, your, you know, your whatever is important to you, and transcend and bring that and flip the switch when it comes to your people too. Because there's something that you said earlier about the affirmation side of things. When the affirmations and the appreciation and the gratitude and just the deep, deep respect that you have for your people will automatically come when you get to have these adult conversations and you get to be unapologetic and you get to be demanding and you get to have unrelenting standards and you set that expectation up front and say, when we have our very limited time together, when we have our weekly meetings, when we have our daily huddles, when we have our time together, I need to come in and I need to be all business and I need the freedom to just go heavy and go hard so I could get out of my head, get it out of my heart, and hand it over to you, because your job is kind of like my cruise director, if you will, is to help me make sense of it all, organize it, and make sure nothing falls through the cracks. And when you get to be in that flow of that type of adult conversation with your employees, then you're able to get so much more done in a short amount of time. And there's just this unexpected time for when they do communicate something to you and say, well, I was thinking, what about this, this, and this? And you're like, oh, that is genius. It's so good. Oh my goodness. I'm so grateful I have you here. That's brilliant. Yes, just go. Whatever you need to do it, please just make it happen. I wish I was smart enough to think about it. That's right there. Will overdo any kind of appreciation sandwich that, like Kelly said, that you have to just, your mind is at constant work and it's around effort and strategy, and then it exhausts you. That what comes out of a natural flow when you are in these adult conversations and when you are in alignment and you do have a superstar employee, that just the affirmations and appreciation and gratitude are flowing 24/7 because it's not being forced. It's not you pushing it. It is very much this give and take that Kelly talked about earlier.
I echo that 100%. That's the exact situation that I have right now with my superstar. And, you know, we adult all day long. And this is the first time since I have been a business owner, which has been for 9 years, that I have had somebody that I can have like you said, I can go heavy, I can go hard, I can get it out, we can be direct. And it's not about feelings. And I sometimes find myself saying, this isn't about you. It's not about you. And I don't even really need to say that. But when we when you can get in there, go heavy and go hard, it is very freeing because you get on with the business of the day. And so quickly you can say, this isn't working. Let's figure out what does. And in this process where I am at the current state of my business is we're in this growth mode. It's basically identifying, okay, here's everything that has to be done to make this business run. I know my superstar is one person. She can only do so many things, but I trust her to figure out everything that needs to be done so then we can hire people to do those other things. If you don't have that person, keep hiring until you find it and move people right along, you know, gently and ever so lovingly, as you said earlier in this podcast, a new opportunity for you to grow and be happy. And, you know, and we're going in a different direction. It's just, you know, it's not the best fit. You don't have to be angry and mean about it. You just, you know, move on. I think my wish for every entrepreneur and every business person is that they don't stop until they get a superstar. And they're like, when will I know? And I said, it's like walking into a dark room. You have no idea what's there, but you flip that light on and all of a sudden your eyes are opened. You get it. You know exactly where you are. That's the feeling you'll have when you get your superstar.
I love that. And it's so, so true. How will you know? You will know because you know when you didn't know. So it's very, very clear once you experience it.
You'll be able to see.
Yes. Yes. So talk to us real quick about, so you've been where you've tolerated way too long. Then you made the decision. Now you've found a superstar and you're still dealing with independent contractors. You have employees. And I know recently you were dealt with another employee on the flip side where you had to make that decision, but it became very, very clear to you. This isn't a lifer, but how can I make it a right now while I build the lifer or find my next superstar for this position? Can you talk to us about this clarity that you are having every single day about moving through this process? You know, I always tell people it's either a hell yes or a hell no. If it's a maybe, you're trying to convince yourself. And so talk to us a little bit about how you're seeing this evolve every single day about getting people off the bus quicker than you have on the past in the past and demanding and really finding and tolerating nothing but superstar performance.
Sure. This is a really important conversation too. In this particular situation that I recently had to deal with, once I realized it was a hell no, but because of the relationship we have, the pricing structure that we had in place, I was still getting a high ROI. So I was still getting benefit for my money. It was not going to be the long play. It wasn't going to run the distance, but it was good enough for that time. And I made a strategic decision to acknowledge that I had a critical vulnerability in the team and that I would begin to create redundancy, not only through people, but also through technology to say, okay, what's causing this vulnerability? How do I fix it? So that as I was able to create redundancy, when I was able to terminate that relationship, I didn't cut my nose off despite my face. So my organization didn't miss a beat. So slowly, I was able to render this person moot in the sense that what they were doing, we were already duplicating. So I just no longer had the need. But in my mind, I'd made the decision, not going to happen, but I wasn't over investing. I wasn't overpaying. And I was like, let me put this person in a box. Let me extract the value I can, but I'm only going to expect a certain amount of value, and I'm not going to be disappointed when I don't get more, you know, the value I'd hoped I would have gotten when I first brought this person on board. And I think that's also something, if you get some professional guidance from somebody who knows how to build and manage a team like I have with you, Molly, because I am not a manager. I'm a visionary. I'm not a manager. And I know what I know and I know what I don't know. And to say, okay, I don't want the bottom to fall out while I'm figuring this out. So let me sideline this team member, figure it out. And then it will naturally, I'll wake up and I'll be, okay, it's time. Now I know I'm good. So you don't create this gaping wound. You're able to say, okay, this is not going to work long-term. Let me stem the tide and then I can make a transition. And I didn't make things worse for me in the process. It's always that balance. If I let this person go, am I going to be worse off until I find somebody? Or if I let them go, am I going to be relieved until I find somebody? But that has to be a very strategic, data-driven decision, not an emotional decision. That became a financial decision, you know, financially in terms of my ROI, and it was still a good ROI. So the data said it's okay to stay until it's not okay to stay. And when the ROI changes, then it was time to make a change. Totally data-driven, no emotion. And it felt very empowering, not only to allow this person to stay, but also then to move on.
Yes, I love that. I love that. Data-driven. And don't create this gaping wound. That was brilliant. It's so, and what a difference between your first one where there was very little KPIs, there were very little ROIs, and it was causing so much emotional and energetic distress for you. Then you experience a superstar. Now you find yourself back at like, not sure this is a lifer. We do the analysis and we're saying, yeah, absolutely. Right now you are getting a tremendous ROI if they just focus on X, Y, and Z that they are doing very, very well. Eliminate the rest and delegate it elsewhere. And the key thing was that you took all the emotion out of it. You went right to the data. And what is the impact on me as an entrepreneur, as a business owner, if I let this person go or if I let this person stay for now? And I love just that, and that clarity that you had this time around of being able to even, you know, it was just so self-guided. It was very, very clear. You're like, yep, I ran the numbers, I looked at the data, and it's going to work for now. And this is going to be my exit strategy.
Absolutely. And it's okay to take time to implement a decision. When we say, make sure you fire fast, that doesn't mean that you have to kick them off the premises in the next 30 minutes. It means that you have to make a strategic decision to pivot and begin to implement and then have a strategic exit strategy, or there you go, a strategy in and of itself. You know, how are you going to have this person exit? And in light of your entire organization and all of the factors at play, that's still firing fast because you're making a decision to go in a different direction, but reducing the collateral damage from the, you know, inevitable explosion.
So, so rich. Wow. Well, we could talk all day, Kelly. I cannot thank you enough for your wisdom today. So many great tips for our listeners about how to fire fast, again, not within 30 minutes, and how to unapologetically demand that you are hiring superstars that understand what it means to lead an entrepreneur, what it means to lead an attorney while protecting your time, protecting your energy, protecting your business, and really being invested in the big picture.
Well, it has been a delight to talk with you. And for everybody out there listening, if you are not an expert in hiring and managing teams, don't walk, but run to Molly.
Thank you.
Absorb her resources, start to read her blog, whatever that is. She's a font of wisdom. And I knew when it was time to build a team. I knew of Molly before we actually, you know, met some time ago as we were talking at the beginning of the podcast. And then I said, I'm not going to do this without Molly because I know her reputation and I know the resources. And it's so empowering as a business owner to say, I don't know this, but I know someone who does. So build the brain trust, your circle of advisors, get professional support, get out of your own head, get perspective, and then have your 20 seconds of insane courage. I love that. It's like, be fierce, but that you can't even say it better than that. 20 seconds of insane courage. I mean, unbelievable. Thank you, Molly. What a pleasure. And thank you for this podcast. And thank you for everything that you do. You're a superstar.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. And I'm passionate about finding and crafting and supporting attorneys with finding superstars such as Kelly has. So thank you for being our guest today. And for any of our listeners today, if you would like to learn more about how to find and hire and train superstars, please feel free to go to our website, hiringandempowering.com. And on the homepage, you can see a free gift for you, Entrepreneurs in Entrepreneurs World, How to Empower Your Employees to Step Up and Lead. And it's a book that we have down there for free download on our homepage. And it'll be very much in alignment with what we've shared today in regards to how to create superstars and how to shapeshift your existing employees that do have the mindset, the emotional intelligence to becoming what we like to call entrepreneurs in entrepreneurs' world. So again, thank you so much, Kelly. And for all of our listeners here, we look forward to your feedback. If you want to go and download the book or drop a comment in today's podcast for Kelly and I, we'd love to hear from you.